Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and want to thank TechBunch for having the antithesis of tech to come and talk to you on tech. So it's very interesting for me to come here and exchange ideas and hopefully get your participation as well on a subject that should be exercising the minds of all of us, and that's really the future. What is the future going to be like? What is the role of technology going to be like? What are consumers going to be doing? And in all this, there is a fair amount of crystal ball gazing. There is a lot of looking at trends, which I will share with you. At the end of it all, maybe none of this comes true. And that's also the hard reality of our lives, that what we propose, somebody else's whim or fancy disposes. So in this conversation, hopefully for the next 30-35 minutes, I'll take you on a journey, which I do hope is interesting. Now, one of the things that we have to remember, that good old Shakespeare said very wisely, if you can look into the seeds of time and say which grain will grow and which will not, speak then unto me. So this is the treacherous path. This is the path of looking into the future that well and truly is unknown, and yet at the same time, we have to find the dots, connect the dots, and hopefully make some sense of it. And unless we discover the future, or unless we are able to program ourselves to think about the future, I believe that we will become like the dinosaurs, which have been long extinct. And therefore, I would like to introduce Mr. Shakespeare to Mr. Voltaire, the French philosopher. And the French philosopher Voltaire, in The Portable Voltaire, said, it is said that the present is pregnant with the future. So it gives us hope that there is an element in the present that defines the future for all of us. In fact, I won't stop at these two. Good old Kabir, the famous bard of India, and probably a lot more relevant today than he has ever been, said once, he said, Jin dhunda tin paiya, gehre pani paithi, main boodi duban dari, rahi kinare baithi. The one who goes to the bottom of the sea finds the pearl. The one who sits by the banks just lies in wait. That indeed is a challenge of our times. So whether you are brand marketers here, whether you are technology experts, whether you are startups or you are already started up, whether you are part of organizations which are happening or which have happened, the fact of the matter is, you need to be cognizant of the fact that you need to prepare yourself for the future and at least have the capability to be able to look at the facets that will determine the future. So what is it that I'm going to be talking about? I'm going to be talking about the trends in terms of statistics, in terms of behaviors, in terms of overall trends. What is really happening, and what are some of the facets and features that is going to become important in understanding who's our consumer, where does he or she shop, what does he or she see, what does he or she buy, and what are going to be the determinants of business models as we look forward. So there's a bit of crystal gazing here. It is not all stuff that is necessarily fully tractable to all of us. And yet it is important for us to understand that unless we understand some of these essential behaviors, some of which are anecdotally extremely true, we will not be preparing ourselves as companies, as business models, and as people who are vested with the responsibility of generating either revenue or return or a combination of both. Now, if you look at a step further, what are some of the trends that are making the world a different place? If you look at the statistics, we are becoming increasingly a digital economy, and increasingly we are finding that consumer behaviors are being determined by the digital world. In every sense of the term, shopping habits, media habits, understanding of the future, understanding of the present, all of these are becoming extremely important to us to understand as to how the consumer is going to evolve and how the consumer, in fact, has evolved. So in this digital age, the way in which we make, the way in which we sell, because if you look at organizations, making, selling, and hiring are the three essential elements that come in. I'm not saying that other functions are not important. So if you're a finance guy, don't get me wrong. The fact of the matter is, an organization makes, an organization sells, and an organization hires. How is making likely to change dramatically? Remember Amazon Dash? What it seeks to do for you is to be able to load on your essentials at a press of a button and to be able to replenish almost automatically. That means that if you're a brand marketer, you had better be part of that essential. It's no longer determinate to say that, look, I am going to build my brand over a period of time, and in the next 25, 50 years, I'm going to have a situation where my brand is going to be salient. You'd better be salient today. And Amazon Dash will make that happen. And if that happens, that means that it is not just mass manufacturing, but the consumers can also look at it from the point of customization. How do I customize these products? What dash of spice do I need? When in Maggie I look at making recipes, that's exactly what we're trying to do, is how do we try and ensure that we are able to give a personalized tweak to it. So you're going to be having the challenge of trying to have two conflicting ideas and still be harmonious. That is the sign, they say, of an agile mind, of a mind that is capable of absorbing the present and also about undertaking the task of the future. So which means that water can not only nourish, water can also destroy. Which means both the thoughts of water being a source of nourishment and destruction has to be put in your head. So making itself is going to involve enormous amounts of changes that take place. Selling, yet again, is going to be very, very different. Different in terms of channels, different in terms of capabilities. Companies who are today looking at a single retail model will have to look at splicing different models. Business to consumer, B to C to C, C to B. Different combinatorials are happening in the world of business modeling. That means that you have to have the capability to be able to work with different business models. And that is always a challenge for many, many organizations. And because of the digital connectivity that is taking place today, and we all know it, by 2030, 77% of the population in India would be those who are either millennials or Generation Z, which means that the habits that they have are going to completely determine whether you're going to be a brand or whether you're going to perish. In 2016, YouTube had 20 channels in India with a subscription of more than 1 million. In 2018, it is 600. It's exploding. What are we going to do about it? India today consumes more data than China. The cost of a gigabyte of information in India is 26 cents. It is $75 in Zimbabwe. It is $15 in the US. We are consuming more and more and more and more. In the old days, the viewing of videos was rare. We never had it, right? We saw movies and documentaries. Today, video viewing and the convergence of aspirations is becoming the reality of consumer behaviors. Earlier, TikTok was what the grandfather clock did. Today, it is goofy stuff that people put to each other to make themselves famous. So all of this is going to become extremely important for companies, not just startups, but also mature organizations to be capable of absorbing. Because if you don't do it, you're going to be history. So either you're part of that core brand list that matters, that gets put onto Amazon Dash, or you become a niche specialized brand. Go the way of Japan, where today you've got aquariums and you've got little patches where you can grow your own food. IKEA, I believe, is also encouraging growing your own food. So both these trends are going to be an important facet, at least, of companies and organizations which are into making stuff for people or providing service for people. Hiring is going to be a very, very different world. The economy of the future is more likely to be a gig economy. Steady jobs and incomes are going to be a thing of the past. Vlogging will make more money than flogging in a company. That is the reality. It is probably going to be employee to consumer or employee to company, E2C. Might be the new model that we're talking about. So all these are trends and changes that will take place and that are happening. September 2018 is a very important date in the history of the world. And why is it important? It's important that from the agrarian times of 10,000 years, in September 2018, just over half the population of the world, 3.9 billion people, joined the ranks of the middle class. Today, we are more a middle class world than a poor world. India alone, 57% of our population would technically be classifiable as a middle class population. 15% is the level of acute poverty. That means that this is a time, my friends, all CXOs in this room should be delighting, because this is the kind of opportunity that you need in order to seed your ideas, your products, your services, and your thoughts for the future. This is becoming a significant point. And incidentally, 2018 is also the year that marked half the global population being on the internet. Half the global population has today gone on to the internet. In the next 10, 15 years, it is estimated that 710 million people across the world will join the ranks of the digital, most of it from Asia and Africa. Most of it, therefore, will be those who would be watching the stuff that we want to watch. And I think that is the kind of overall trend and revolution that is likely to take over us as we move forward. So the rise of the great Indian middle class is not only a question of urbanization. Urbanization today, anywhere between 31-32%, is likely to be about 40% by 2030. What's more important is to understand, and this is data published by Oxford Economics, that says that in the top 10 cities in the world, in growth of GDP, many of the cities will come from India. And the city mentioned as number one, and that should be a great pride to those who belong to that city, is the city of Surat. Right? Surat is seen to be the city that is likely to be the fastest growing in terms of its GDP. That's interesting for us. We talked about the young. The young population of India today is likely to become even more resilient as we move forward. The median age in 2030 for India is going to be 31. Yes, 31. It's going to be 42 for China and roughly the same for the United States. That clearly means that the class that is going to be exhibiting the behaviors that I talked about are going to be the people who are going to decide what to buy and when to buy. Connectivity, therefore, has become an essential element of the strategies that you formulate and that you form. You all know it. There's nothing new about it. There was a time when in my days as a brand manager or as a marketing person, digital was a tick in the box, right? We ticked it at the end of the whole calendar because somebody, some senior guy would say, "Bhai, digital ko kiya ki nahi kiya?" And we said, digital, yes. We had digital agencies. We invited agencies to come and talk to us stuff that we never understood. And we said, how clever, right? And we allocated our budgets generously and handsomely to them without having an iota of an idea of what the return on investment would be. But that's what it is today. Today, this is an essential element of who we are and what we are. And therefore, connectivity and connectedness is probably going to be the single most important determinant of whether you are going to be a successful business proposition or a has-been. This is not to take out the importance of operational effectiveness and cost effectiveness and value effectiveness and value propositions and all that. Those are all taken as given. But what will be at the cutting edge, even in India, would be the capability of organizations to leverage technology and connectivity in order to enhance the offering and the experience. Because today we are no longer talking about brands, we're talking about experiences. What experience does a brand give me? When I put out as a company, Ask Nestle, it is not done in order to promote all the brands of the company. It is in order to promote a single truth that if you are looking for valid, scientifically correct information on nutrition, ask Nestle. Being the world's biggest food, beverage, and nutrition company, scientific facts are available to us, easily digestible in a consumer form. That then becomes the credibility platform for the organization. That then becomes the platform on which consumers engage in order to make their choices, some of which could be brands of my company, a lot of which could be other propositions, other brands, and other materials that they choose to use. So this is, therefore, ladies and gentlemen, for me an important cusp in the journey that we take forward. The changes are veritable. The changes are discernible. The changes are not just anecdotal, but from the data and statistics that we see, it is likely to be secular. And I think this is the kind of issues that should be exercising us. So in a sense, India is enjoying the Kamadhenu of its demographic dividend. Liberalization is playing a very, very important part. Brand choices are becoming manifold. There was a time when if you had your product on the shelf, you are guaranteed an offtake. Many of us have made our careers in shortage economies, right? We had a few brands, a few SKUs, you put it on the shelf and everything worked. Today, the proclivity to consume different brands, to consume different products, the proclivity for premiumization is huge. In 2015, about 16% of the total consumer expense was on premium products. Today, it is close to a fourth. Trends which we thought would not be important as far as this country were concerned have become important. Whoever talked about veganism, whoever talked about organic, whoever talked about nutrition that was specialized, all this was considered to be Western phenomenon. Today, they have taken an Indian twist and become Indian phenomenon. Digital natives, we talked about it. I think one of the biggest trends that I am observing in the market, and since I travel a fair bit, is the convergence of aspirations. Tier 2 and Tier 3 towns are no longer lesser brothers and sisters. They have the same aspirations. When we launched Nescafe E, which is our coffee machine on Amazon, I was hoping that maybe Mumbai and Delhi and Bangalore and a few other cities would be interested in a product of this kind. 600 towns ordered. 600 towns. It cost 6,500 bucks a piece. 600 towns ordered this product. So I said, wow, that's what the consumption class of India is. Now, you have to make that happen. It doesn't happen automatically. Maybe it happens in one, it doesn't happen in the other. But that is the sheer opportunity. The reason why I believe startups are successful, some of them are successful in this country, is because they have found those spaces which can be occupied extremely well to create sustainable business models and which can be continued for a long period of time before any big guy in the industry realizes that there is an opportunity there. So, it's both digital and discerning. Discerning has also become an important facet of what we buy when we buy. Personalization is no longer just a word. Personalization has now become the sine qua non of companies seeking the path of the consumer's wallet, not only on products which are high-end, but also in products which are not necessarily that expensive. So as I mentioned before, the dash buttons are one categories of products that you need to be on. There are a lot of other product categories where there are opportunities which are very clear. It is therefore, ladies and gentlemen, that I speak as an optimist on the Kamadhenu effect that is taking over this country. It is one thing to keep looking at economic statistics and saying, look, this is not working, that's not working. You know, there's no end to it. We can look at it from different dimensions and skin the cat. What is essentially happening today is if there is a consumer revolution that is taking place in terms of channel, in terms of behavior, in terms of aspirations, in terms of price points, in terms of premium, in terms of the role of digital, role of society, whatever you have, I think this is becoming very clearly the mix that looks like it will go forward for the future. The convergence is all about not just buying the same, but buying more and buying better. No one is today talking about the same kind of products, the same kind of product categories, and the same kind of uniformities across the realm of this country. The length and breadth of this country is becoming a lot richer. And that is where the role of analytics, the role of data mining, the role of understanding each of these elements is becoming more and more important. So if I were to look at it, I have given you my piece. I've said what I think is likely to be the important issues that are overtaking the country. The rise of the great Indian middle class, the Kamadhenu of demographic dividend, and consuming convergence that is taking place across a broad spectrum of this country. These are important trends that are already taking place. There's nothing new in what I've said. Now, if you were to be the person to hold two conflicting thoughts in your head and still be harmonious, what is the future going to look like? And if indeed Voltaire and what Voltaire said is true, that the future is already there in the present and that the present is pregnant with the future, what could be some of the characteristics that we can look for? So I'm going to be talking about three broad trends: maximal lifestyle, and I'll come to it, individualized reality, and exponential intelligence. But ladies and gentlemen, this is Tech Munch, right? We are here to be interactive. We are here not just to listen to my views, but I believe that crowdsourcing of ideas is extremely important if we are all to coalesce to a future that we agree is going to be important for all of us. So therefore, I would request you all that there is a voting mechanism that has been put. If you could just put down the site, this is what you have to log on to. And I would request you at the end of this piece to vote on which trend do you think is likely to be the most manifest as we move forward. Now, all of this is crystal ball gazing. All of this is what you think is important in the context of your business. And here is a guy who's primarily been a consumer goods fellow. I mean, I don't know any other industry except for consumer goods. And the way I see it is the way that I will explain to you about it. Can we move on? Have you all done your bit to scan it? Okay, so let me move. Wow. Seems that you guys have already made up your minds on it, right? So as the way you see it is lifestyle, reality, and exponential intelligence, you give a lot of weight to the individualized reality, right? And why not? That's the generation that is sitting in this room. It is all about individual behaviors that is likely to impact us in 2030. So let's move on what really I mean by maximum lifestyle. Reflect on your own capabilities of reading a book versus watching a video. Look at your own attention span that has come to pass ever since you've had this telephone instrument called the iPhone or Samsung or whatever else in the palm of your hand. Your attention spans have become much shorter. Your ability today to read through long texts and to watch for information over extended periods of time is slowly but steadily vanishing. You are, in a sense, trying to maximize the return on your energy. So you look for top 10 news in 10 minutes, you scour through Daily Hunt, you look for these six second videos, by the time you see it, it's gone, right? Many of us are extremely happy if somebody has spent 26 seconds on our site. Wow, look at the amount of time that somebody has spent. But that's the reality. Increasingly, I don't call it sensationalism, increasingly, with lowered attention spans, you need enormous amount of content to make things happen. The quality of the content is more important than the length of the content. And therefore, in everything, maximizing the return on your energy, your ROI on energy, is today becoming the harsh reality. And this is only going to exacerbate into the future. You're going to have less and less opportunities for involvement and indulgence on an extended basis, because that luxury your consumer is not going to give you. If I don't make sense in 10 seconds, I'm gone. It's a bit like a job interview. You know, in the old days when I got interviewed for a job, half an hour, 45 minutes, let's have sandwich together, let's have a cup of coffee. Now it is in and out, right? What are you doing? What are you going to do? Do you want my job? You don't want my job? What's your salary? What do you want to do? What's your purpose? What's your value? This, that, and the other, out, right? Next. That's how it is. But this is only going to exacerbate. This month, I believe the 325 million searches have happened on the word lifestyle hacking on Google. Lifestyle hacking is today becoming one of the most important trends, and this is only going to increase. Hacking on nutrition, keto diets, right? Whether you're talking about, you know, some other fads on nutrition, whether you're talking about cleaning up your cupboards, whether you're talking about making a healthier lifestyle, whether you're talking about better jogging, whatever you're talking about. Today, somebody is propagating 4-hour work weeks, right? Work for 4 hours. Let's have and relax for the rest of the time. Now, all these are clearly becoming very, very important. Are you part of that hack or not? That is going to be the question. Are you going to be sought for what you stand for rather than what you stood for? So many of us work with brands that are heritage brands, right? If I talk about a brand like Maggi, for example, it is a 100-year-old brand. I can't keep telling you guys that this is a 100-year-old brand and therefore, you know, we should be talking about its heritage. Its heritage is only relevant in terms of its relevance for the future. That's it. So if I don't contemporize it, I'm going to have a lot of problems in making this work for the future. So whether it is new recipe-led, we just launched something called Fusion, right? Which is all about the Asian taste that you can get. You know, we looked at atta, we looked at different combinations, different products, different categories, getting into nutrition for toddlers, et cetera, et cetera. All of these are in this realm of trying to include yourself onto that select list where consumers say, I will not exercise much discretion, I will buy it because I trust it. So that's the question of hacking lifestyles. Shared economies are becoming more and more important. Millennial behaviors and Generation Z behaviors, while they are different, are still consonant with one single element, which is that people are very comfortable with the sharing economy. They are not in the acquisitive mode for everything that you can think of. In 2015, I believe in San Francisco, 20% of the Visa cards, 20% of the Visa cards were used on sharing economy platforms. During demonetization in India, in Bengaluru was one of the cities that joined the 80 cities across the world that beat this record. So today we have, in our own country, we have increasingly greater relevance being played as far as the sharing economy is concerned. So in terms of lifestyle, these would be some of the important kind of indicators of change that we are going to have. Maximizing your energy and the returns, hacking lifestyles, finding personalized solutions and not just global solutions, and also elements of your brands, elements of your propositions, elements of your platforms that are going to hook on to the sharing economy. Right? We can call it whatever you want to, but this is an essential element of the journey that is likely to take place. Individualized realities. We talked about routine purchase being automated. This is the Amazon Dash that is happening. We choose a few brands, we put them on that replenishment list, it happens. Today we are looking at refrigerators being replenished as well. All of this with the power of artificial intelligence, all of this with the power of machine learning, all of this with the power of transformative technologies that are being used worldwide. Now, we can all slumber and say, yeah, it is 25 years away in India, it is going to be 50 years away in India. A fact of the matter is, guys, we have grown from being nowhere on the digital usage, on the data usage list in the world, to becoming number one in the short span of 3 to 4 years. Today, when we talk about transformative technologies that are coming into this country, these are real, and this will only become much bigger. This then gets into the second area, bespoke solutions. We talked about it. Personalization is going to become a very, very important facet of what we seek to do as marketeers. Find a personalization element in the service or the brand or the proposition that you're seeking. If you are going to be plain Jane, it's nice to be plain Jane, but you're not going to be picked up by very many people, because the fact of the matter is they don't see differentiation. Today, differentiation is meaning not just in terms of the physical attributes of whatever you make or sell. It is in terms of the differentiated attributes on service, on offerings, on sustainability, on various other things. Brands like Patagonia don't exist simply because they make nice jackets. They stand for something. How is this going to become part of your brand is a question that you need to have. The service economy, this is becoming bigger and bigger and bigger. And in the service economy, more and more and greater elements of differentiation is going to come in. Disruptive strategies are happening in the service economy that we need to be cognizant of. So, in individualized reality, automation of routine, seeking personalization and bespoke solutions, and a service economy orientation is going to be strong features of what we are talking about. The third trend is on exponential intelligence, automation. AI may be something that we all fear, but AI is probably going to simplify a lot of the routinized, complicated procedures that we have today. And I strongly believe that in industry, AI will create a new genre of jobs. And that is what we need to be focused on, not just on the destructive elements that is going to take as far as our economy or our society is concerned. There was a time, there is a time, when we seek degrees, right? MBAs and PhDs and DSCs and God knows what else, BTECs and stuff like that, right? So simple masters of arts in economics like me are no longer very meaningful people. The world of tomorrow is going to be a world where skills are going to be more important than books. Coursera and massive online courses are going to be far more relevant than the degrees and the diplomas that youngsters pick up along the way. Today you're seeing that happening. Today you're seeing that happening. The unemployment in India amongst the highly educated is higher than the unemployment amongst the lesser skilled people. I'm not saying that, you know, we should all be less skilled people, but I'm saying that you're already seeing the reverse factor happening. That if knowledge doesn't translate into skill, there is no hope. There is no hope. And increasingly, the way in which economies operate are becoming more and more democratized. There is a lot more of seeking out, a lot more of I would say at one level, equalization that is taking place. And I think that is an important element of who we are. So I talked about maximal lifestyle, individualized reality, and exponential intelligence. And you guys have already made up your mind. So therefore, it's relatively easy for me to say that you all think that clearly the individualized reality is going to be something that is going to be a lot more important. I'd only say that you need to watch out for all of these trends, because some of these are likely to swamp your industry faster than you think. And I think that is a challenge that all of us need to be watchful of. So what do we need? All these are prognostications of trends. What do organizations need in order to combat and to cope with a new reality, a new future that is likely to happen? The first and most important characteristic is what I call neuroplasticity. This is the capability of organizations to adapt to change. This is the capability of the organizational brain to not only change its position, but also change its size. It's difficult to conceptualize because our own heads, unfortunately, don't give us horns that we can put in an extra bit of brain in, right? So we don't have backups to brains, unfortunately, right? But the fact of the matter is that neuroplasticity in organizations is probably going to be the single most important skill. And neuroplasticity of organizations are often affected by two things. Perversely, by leadership, who allow no plasticity but conformity. And number two is incapacity to see the reality as it emerges. Because the capability to see reality in the eyes is a very, very difficult proposition. It's very uncomfortable to me. And I think that is a characteristic that organizations need to build. Co-creation, collaboration, and co-ownership. And as I'll come to, corporate with a conscience. So we talked about neuroplasticity. Where does it come? In production. You are being producing, so you are a company that is both in the standard Amazon Dash fixture and also in the personalization. Your manufacturing model is disrupted. Hey guys, 25% of my SKUs are a part of Amazon Dash, which is part of automatic replenishment. 75% is personalized. Everybody up and down the line will say, oh yeah, but that's not possible. This is small scale, return on investment is low, et cetera, shareholders will be unhappy, blah, 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 everything will start. That is your reality. Business models. I am a direct business to customer model. That's it. I'm not interested in having e-commerce. I'm not interested in having other spatial models. I'm not interested in having, like for example, Dollar Shave Clubs. That's not part of my business model. Fact of the matter is, if you don't face it, you're going to perish. This is a hard reality of being capable of working with different business models in the context of where you are. Flexi employment. This is what I talked about in some sense. Employee to company, E to C. I don't want to be working 9 to 5 in your job and logging in and logging out and attending sundry meetings. I want to work 6 hours from home in a quiet corner, sipping my latte, having my cat next to me and the husband very far away, and having the kids at school and nobody's bothered about it, right? I want to work in that economy. The gig economy is a reality. People are preferring it. People are choosing it. And this is probably going to mean that your whole HR department would need to be disbanded. What are you going to be recruiting? I want to work for 3 hours with you. Sorry, I've got 18 contracts that are open. You're one of those contracts. Oh no, but we are keeping talent out here. We are doing this, we are doing that. You're X, Y, and Z, heritage company, great brands, great people. This is a reality that all of us have to take, especially the big ones have to swallow it even harder. So hopefully by that time, people like me would have happily retired, right? And that's a different thing altogether. But these are some of the things that are going to hit us. Co-creation. Consumers today want to co-create with you. How many examples of co-creation are you seeing happening? We ourselves do it. In our brands, we co-create with consumers. We have panels where they decide on what recipes they want to eat, and some of it filters through and comes out as products. Consumers want a stake in whatever you are doing, right? Recent example, you've got Dettol, which has created something with consumers. Partnerships are becoming more and more important. And of course, employees are also seeking co-ownership in what they do. Stakeholding is not a question of just shareholders and suppliers. Today, employees are also becoming, and they will increasingly become, greater people who ask for co-ownership of initiatives that are happening within organizations. So here again, there is going to be a transformative change that takes place. And last but not the least, today purpose is becoming more important than price point. Consumers are increasingly wanting to know the history, the geography, the muscles, the bones, the fiber, the intention, the brain, the brawn, everything about your brand. The more we are able to crystallize it in terms of clarity of thought, of transparency and building trust, the better off we are. Sustainability also means the responsibility of corporates to take on the task of doing the things that they are expecting till yesterday the government to do, i.e. water, i.e. plastics, i.e. pollution. How are we going to get involved as corporates? Each one of you here is not just a responsible, proud citizen of this country, but you're also part of a corporate. So when I go out and pick up garbage in Trans Jamuna with my people, I feel it is one way in which I can do my little act. I'm not going to clean the whole planet. But if I do this, over a period of time, maybe I inspire others to be able to do the same thing. And maybe we are able to have cleaner neighborhoods. And maybe we are able to have less filth on the streets the way we see it. Look at the backflow that happened on Juhu a few days back. All that plastic came guzzling out of the sea. Skill building. Again, skill building involves a lot more than just having formalized training programs. It is a continuous process that organizations need to invest in for the future. And the future is going to be more important. Why? Because remember, it is going to be skills and not books. If that is going to be true, then you'd better have a stronger program of skill development and not have these variable training budgets which get cut out every time you have a business downturn, right? Most corporates, if there's a downturn, 90% of the training budget gets out of it. Oh, okay, yeah, let him go next time for a training program. We don't understand that skill development is an important part of whatever we're doing. The ecosystem view is completely changing. In the future, organizations will be measured on the purpose, on the values, on their adherence to keeping the ecosystem intact in the space in which they are operating. Nobody is going to be happy with somebody who's producing a huge amount of returns and polluting like hell, or doing things that are going to be non-transparent or that are going to infringe upon the rights of societies and communities. All of us have to be cognizant of it. Maybe we were not, we need to be. So, corporate with a conscience, neuroplasticity, co-creation, collaboration, and co-ownership are going to be important elements of where the world and where we need to be in order to be able to cope with the trends that we talked about. I believe that you need also to participate on those three trends. Because I would like to hear from you as to what do you think in terms of these three elements that we talked about, in terms of neuroplasticity, in terms of conscience, what do you think in overall terms you would need to make the largest transformational shift in? Everything is important. At TechMunch, every aspect of organization and technology is critical, but what is going to make it even more relevant in the context of where you operate? Interesting that co-creations, collaboration, and co-ownership is what you see, and possibly so. Because if you don't have these essential elements, you probably don't have a business. So where is the conscience and where is the neuroplasticity going to be if there is no body to house the brain? Right? So you see the critical trends that are happening, and I want to leave you with this thought by this wonderful author, and I'm sure you've read the book, Sapiens. History is going to be made by people who are capable of connecting the dots, who are capable of making the transitions who are capable of doing what Kabir said, getting down to the bottom of the sea to mine the pearl. And as Hariri rightly says, history is something that very few people have been doing while everyone else was plowing fields and carrying water buckets. So, ladies and gentlemen, I thank you very much for your time, for your attention in listening to me. These are views that I hold. These are views based on my own experience of whatever I've seen, whatever I'm seeing, and whatever I either look forward to with trepidation or with hope to see. But I would only want to wish you all the very best in capability to transform technology into core propositions that sustain whichever business model, whichever business, and whichever product you are in the process of either marketing or looking at for the future. Thank you all very much.
Ladies and gentlemen, a huge round of applause for none other than Suresh Narayanan. Thank you so much, sir, for that great session. May we request you to kindly join us on the center stage. And if I may request Mr. Naval Ahuja, co-founder and director, Exchange for Media Group, to join us. Ladies and gentlemen, a huge round of applause for both the honorary gentlemen out there.